What we saw in the last unit is that we can take a Hermitian matrix A and reduce it to a real valued tridiagonal matrix. And the question now is, can we somehow take advantage of the fact that this is a tridiagonal matrix when we execute the QR algorithm? Now, in the QR algorithm, what did we do? We computed a QR factorization of matrix A, and then we multiplied the resulting R by the matrix Q. And that is if we don't incorporate shifting, which is something we'll deal with later. Okay, now, we could go back to our householder-based QR factorization and say, okay, we'll go ahead and apply householder transformations to make this matrix into an upper triangular matrix R. But notice that there are a whole bunch of zeros already in this matrix, and it would be nice to take advantage of that. So, how could we do that? Well, if we had a simple mechanism by which to take linear combinations of these two rows, leaving all the other rows alone in order to introduce a zero right here, then we could introduce a zero here, and then subsequently introduce a zero here, and just kind of iterate along, leaving us eventually with an upper triangular matrix. And then maybe, just like when we did householder QR factorization and we didn't actually explicitly form Q, maybe we can take those transformations and apply them one by one as opposed to forming Q. And notice that it's obviously important that we use only unitary matrices to do this. Now, what kind of unitary matrices are at our disposal? Well, we could just say, we can compute a householder transformation just off of these two entries, thereby introducing a zero. But it turns out that that requires more computation than if we use another tool, which is known as a Givens rotation, named after someone named Givens. And what is a Givens rotation? Well, if you have a vector with two entries, let's call it chi and psi, then one can compute a rotation, let's call it gamma sigma minus sigma gamma, such that the result is equal to something that has a zero here. But we saw that rotations, if these represent the cosine and sine of an angle, we know that rotations preserve length, and therefore we know that this first entry we can take to be the 2 norm of this vector right here. How shall we write that 2 norm? Well, I guess it's the 2 norm of chi psi. Okay, and then you could say, yeah, and we can make it plus or minus, and actually in this particular case we can just make sure that it's always positive. Okay, how would we compute that cosine and sine? Well, it turns out that there's a simple formula for that will let you verify in a homework.